Everybody, and welcome once again to the AIR Bookclub Podcast. I'm your host, Aspire, and joining me today, we have Biscuit Day.
Hey, everybody.
The wonderful Eotheria.
Salutations.
The Master Analyst, Bowie.
Yeah, hello.
The King of Key Points, Eisenkobu.
I have awakened to dazzling light.
And we're here for the AIR Route. The final episode of the AIR Book Club Podcast. I hope you're excited because we have a lot to talk about. And like I say every episode, we have a lot to talk about. This time we really have a lot to talk about.
It's like we're like the Conan O'Brien of podcasts.
But we really mean it this time. We really mean it.
Really, really mean it.
We don't have a lot to talk about. We have too much to talk about.
Yep. And I don't know, like, the general feeling I'm getting is a lot of us, while we have a lot to talk about, we still don't understand everything because this route is fucking cryptic.
Yeah, we got a lot to talk about, but we have no clue what we're talking about.
Should be really exciting.
But I hope you're excited for it as I am, because I feel like everyone's like come together for this episode and like really dug deep, and I want to see what's come out. And through the discussion, and hopefully we'll reach some sort of better understanding of what the hell this route is about. But before we get into the really heavy stuff, I'd just like to start off with the beginning of the route. So we're going to pan back, dial back all the way. We've just come out of Summer Route, and basically we're starting the game, and it turns out that we're a bird now for some reason. That's kind of weird. So let's talk about this. What do you guys like think of the new perspective, and like how do you feel coming into this route? Jared, Ethereum, what do you think?
Well, I initially did not like it. I was like, ugh. But then after I finished the whole thing as a whole, and I can like kind of reflected on it, I was like, yeah, that was a good decision. I can respect that.
I personally loved it. Anybody else got, like, any, like, how did some of you, like, feel just entering this route, not knowing what's going on?
The first time I read this route, I didn't like it very much.
Yeah?
Yeah. And it was for a very silly reason that now, and I only bring this up because of you mentioning the whole, you know, we're a bird now. That's weird. I didn't like it at first. And the reason I didn't like it is because we're kind of this outer perspective, almost. Like, we are a character, but we're still just kind of, like, getting to see things from a different perspective, which is very important in this route.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're a bird, it's not really, like, written all that great, I guess. It's very to the point. And when I was reading it for the first time, because we weren't really getting too much of an exciting, like, inner monologue or anything, I didn't like it very much. I was just like, this is kind of dull. I'm just a dumb bird. This isn't interesting. and that's how I honestly felt. And whenever people would ask me about AIR, I would just kind of be like, I didn't really like the way it was written, and that was why. But now that I think about it, just the amount of content and why it was presented the way it was, it actually makes a lot of sense for them to do it that way, because if we did have that entire crazy inner monologue and stuff going on all the time,
yeah, it was still there. It's just
it would have stretched out quite a bit, and it probably would have been like not as impactful. So I like it now, didn't like it before.
Yeah exactly. That's how I felt.
I liked it from the start personally. Just like, it was a bit jarring at first, being like an animal, like this very like limited creature, I guess. But the ways that they play with that, that you get these inner monologues cool of a non-human creature looking in on a human world, it's very different, and it gives you a very interesting perspective. But what I like most is the fact that they could have just gone with an omniscient narrator, which is probably what they were thinking. But instead they decide to give it a bit more personality by letting you be a creature. And so everything you see is through this creature's eyes. But that doesn't mean, like, they're any less of a narrator, because that bird can go anywhere. Sora can just fly off.
Well, no, you're a bird that can't fly. That's very important.
Well, yeah, sorry. You're right.
You are a bird that cannot fly.
But he can still go anywhere. And whenever he's with someone, I guess people feel this need to, like, talk to him and, you know, share their innermost feelings. Especially if Haruko. It's very interesting.
It brings in a very cool dynamic. And there are a lot of there's a lot of cool symbolism with being a crow. That comes into play. And so it actually turns out to be kind of cool, especially towards the end, like, how it all plays out. But like you said before, you're not a human, obviously, but you're just kind of like this, you are kind of like a narrator of sorts. But because you have this very unbiased, straightforward, like, matter-of-fact perspective, it actually brings in some really cool stuff with the script and, like, the turn of events. One of the things that I just want to bring it up now that's really cool is there's a major turning point where all of these characters aren't really named exactly. Like, he kind of figures out Misuzu really fast, and he's like, "Ah, oh, this is really interesting. I like this person, Misuzu." But everyone else is just kind of like girl, woman, man, and stuff like that. However, there's a really sweet distinction that happens, and it wouldn't happen any other way if you weren't Sora right now. And that's whenever he comes to like Haruko, he changes the name in the script and on the screen changes from woman to mother.
Yeah.
And
I didn't notice that when I was reading, but that was so cool.
Very, very cool little thing that gets thrown in.
The way it plays with presentation is very interesting. I don't know about the whole widescreen thing. I guess it was just kind of there to make things feel different. Because that was one of the key points. That was Aizen's first key point. Did you have any particular thoughts on this, Aizen?
To me, it felt like, like I said in my key point, it kind of gave it a sort of cinematic sort of feel. What I thought of it was it might have to do with Sora's more limited viewpoint of the world as well.
That's kind of the feeling I got.
Yeah, because at one point, When he remembers who he is, the widescreen thing just vanishes, and
it's a really cool transition.
What that implied to me was that as Sora, he doesn't have a full understanding of what's around him, and his senses are quite his knowledge are quite limited.
Mm-hmm.
He can't carry as much as he could as Yukito.
Yeah. I think that's basically what they were trying to go for. Like, that boxed in, it almost feels a little bit claustrophobic at first, because you spent the whole game in, like, I guess, more standard aspect ratio. But this idea that, like, you don't have the full breadth of your vision, it's like you've kind of been squished into a little box. It definitely gives that feeling of being in a body you're not used to. I thought, like, that was conveyed interestingly.
I can see more focused. Like, he's obviously not really connected to, like, the big world and the big picture, but he's also much more precise in, like, the tiny things. Like you're more focused on the characters in this route and not so much the setting, you know?
That's a very valid interpretation, too.
Because the sprites don't get cut. Like, those are still front and center.
Yeah.
But it's just, like, the background's kind of become a little bit more obscure.
Yeah, another point Aizen mentioned was how it's interesting that Kano and Minagi just get one scene in this route. Like, they probably could have gone without showing them at all, but they decided to give them just a little nod. like Sora meets him once. While they're in the story to begin with, that if the focus was mainly on Misuzu and Haruko, were you talking there, Aizen, about like this story of AIR in general, or just this route?
Just this route in particular. It's really jarring that they'd be there to begin with. Like, if these characters aren't important to the plot, then why are they there? It's like, are they there for fan service, or is there some sort of meaning behind this?
It's like a weird mix.
Are they?
It's like they didn't seem all that important. It was almost like fan service because, you know, you can kind of like, for example, I know the Minagi. It's either Minagi or Kano. One of those, I think it might be Kano. It's kind of like an opt-in thing. Like, you either follow Yukito or you see Kano or something like that.
Yeah, that's true.
But, like, it also kind of pays a nod as, like, them as being supporting characters to the story because, like, Minagi, for example, like, sees Sora and it's just kind of, like, you'll get there one day, buddy, you know? It's very supportive.
What's also interesting to me about that, or about those particular scenes, is that since they're not talking to people, and this also kind of relates to Misuzu in sort of a way, since they're not confronting people, more of their personality starts coming out, and
yeah,
they start coming out as like more helpful and more compassionate towards Sora when they weren't so much with Yukito.
That's interesting. But they're definitely not the focus of this route at any rate. I think they're just there because to show that this world is like connected and it's not like we're just in this little cut off world with Misuzu and Haruko, I guess. That's probably what I put it down to. So we've got a lot of stuff to talk about. What about the stars? You want to talk about that for a bit? The whole, Sora compares the stars to a flock of birds who flew into the sky and can't ever come home.
Well, it was interesting imagery, at least, especially coming, you know, from a bird, which would make sense, you know, going back to his limited worldview, he's comparing it to something that he's, you know, got firsthand knowledge of. But I don't know, there's so many different sort of ideas tied to the sky and the stars that get introduced. It's kind of hard to tack down exactly, you know, where he's going with this in particular.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. It's kind of a little off tangent, but like when we were watching Children Who Chase Lost Voices, we were talking about star symbolism, and I think it was Pepe who said that the most common symbolism for stars were like flowers and birds, and I thought that was kind of interesting.
Yeah, because flowers are flowers and birds are like dots in the sky, and they can be confused for stars. I can get that.
I viewed it as, he mentions it's a flock, it looks like a flock of birds, but I feel like the most important piece is that he says they're a flock of birds who can't return home.
Yeah.
And what that brought to my mind is this kind of like, well, where is home for the stars? But,
Or where is home for the birds?
When you think about stars and you think of it as like memories or wishes, you know, wish upon a star, then it's very similar to the actual symbolism in this route about the idea of Sora's return to home in the sky and his inability to fly. So I think about the stars, I think about all those dreams that are just kind of stationary and they can't really return to what brought them there.
Or maybe the girl in the sky might be another analogy you could draw there. Yeah, she's stuck in the sky.
Yeah, it's you can see it as sort of a nod to Kana because it's the last time you see her, she flies into the sky. And then
it's just,
you know, never another
piece. It's another piece of all the things that are connecting, letting us know, you know, that this being that we are is who we have always been. We are continuing to see through the eyes of the man in our story, I guess, for lack of a better way to put it. Even though, you know, Yukito's mother was person. But it's just letting us know we're still in the same shoes I guess.
Yeah. So moving on from that, we have the scene with Micah and her mother visiting the shrine.
I have a lot to say about this.
Do you? Because, this time it hit me, I was like, wait a second, Micah? Oh my god, it's Psyche's sister. Oh my god, yeah, you're in the hospital.
Doesn't it?
It's just like, she keeps coming back. Like I was just talking about in the last one of our, I think it was Mrs. Root episode, how, you know, this Psyche girl, just what was her deal? Like, why was she there? And the idea that she's a little Mrs. Root.
I want to just say it now. If we can hold off on that aspect for just now, because we have more points, because we're just talking about kind of beginning now, and we're starting to transition.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine.
But if we can hold on that for now, but focus on the question here, where Aizen's asking about why Micah thinks that the dinosaur is like why is it her god?
Yeah.
What do you guys think about it? If you were to ask me, Sora, he compares himself to the dinosaur, but this idea is that Micah's like, there's no god here, blah, 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 and all this stuff, talking about, you know, there's no god, which is it's her own perspective. But she finds God in this dinosaur, and just kind of to cut it down as cut and dry as I can put it, I viewed this very much as a symbolism of everyone can have their own god. Like, she's still young, but she was like, this dinosaur was here for me now, as it will be for someone else, so this dinosaur is the god of this land, and that's because I say it is. That's what I believe. It's just kind of like, you don't really need a reason for that. If it's what keeps you going, then cool, you know?
Yeah. Which can definitely tie into a lot of things in AIR, I feel. Just this idea that you need something to believe in, and it doesn't have to be something everybody else believes in, but something that gives you strength and keeps you going, I feel like is important. Yeah, I agree with that. I guess there's this recurring theme in AIR of like objects holding spiritual power and retaining like memories and wishes. There's this big theme of wishes that keeps coming up in AIR, of just like people putting their hopes and dreams into some vessel and hoping that it can bear fruit in the future. And I feel like that's definitely represented through the dinosaur, because Sora, it's like one of his greatest achievements in his life was simply how he could drag that dinosaur and bring it back to the shrine. You know, if he hadn't done that, then at the very end, Misuzu wouldn't have been saved, and she'd probably end up dying. So
it's all part of Sora. He's on his mission, you know? He's still on his mission. We're still that being that's trying to accomplish what we've been trying to accomplish for thousand years.
Well, if you're wanting to look at it as that, as like a receptacle for holding wishes and stuff, then the dinosaur is literally that, because if you remember where it came from, Haruko dropped it there after she mentions that every year for Misuzu's birthday, she keeps trying to give it to her, and she keeps deciding, exactly, no, I'm not going to. And so, you know, that wish of, hey, I want to give her this present, I want to get closer to her, has been stored
built inside Misuzu's wish of, I want a dinosaur.
Yeah, and it's just built up over years and years, yeah. I mean, you could say a similar thing about Yukito's puppet, you know. It keeps coming back to toys, you know. Her toys hold all this, like, this meaning. And this meaning of wanting to give someone happiness. It's very cool. So I guess we should, like, talk about Misuzu here, because, holy crap, I felt so sorry for her. Like, the first time we met her in the common route, I didn't know what to think, really. But now we finally see everything from her perspective, and it's like, oh, she just got rejected by her classmates. She's, like, going to be alone all summer, and she's, like, horribly depressed. And she's like, I'm going to give it one more shot and talk to this random stranger I've never met. It's like, wish me luck, Sora. It's just like, oh my god. I feel so bad.
It really sets up her Wooby character.
Yeah, Wooby, that's the word I was looking for. But it also, it just seeing those scenes in new light was just like, really hot
woman. Gives you a whole new perspective on, like, how tragic it is, but how insanely strong Misuzu is.
Yeah,
like totally.
She's astoundingly confident and courageous.
Like I said earlier, because she's not talking to a person, Misuzu feels like that she can display her feelings a bit more freely among Sora because
doesn't have to hide anything.
So through Sora's eyes, we end up figuring out her motives as to why she was doing all she was going after Yukito and being all friendly to him in Dream. So
I mean, she says to Sora whenever she's just like, "Well, I'll just be alone. It's fine. It doesn't matter. I don't need anything." She's like, she thinks about, well, what about that guy over there still? And she's just like, she says that's like, it's her opportunity because he's someone that's not from there and doesn't have any, like, biases or knows about her issue, that he'll be the first person that can, like, see her as normal.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, well, I'm gonna try making friends again. Because the lesson here is, well, there's always second chances. And, like, that's the way I saw it. And because she's so confident, it's like, she's never gonna give up. Like, regardless of what happens. She's like, there's always new experiences right in front of you, and this was hers. I'm gonna go meet this person, and we're gonna be friends. That's what she said.
It was so good, like, just seeing all those new common scenes from her perspective, and actually getting a sprite of Yukito was nice. But then what? I think Yukito wasn't so relevant in this route.
He's really not.
It makes me really sad because he's such an amazing character, but I feel like his hand was the Heron roots, and once that's over, it's like they don't have a need for him anymore.
I think it's because it's like we're kind of beyond that, I guess. Like, that's kind of how I view that. Like, that stage is over and we're moving forward.
Yeah.
Like, this is the new step.
I guess you're right. I'm not complaining about what we got.
Yukito's existence was integral for them to be able to continue making those steps. So I still found it very important.
Yeah, Yukito was like the, you know, the setup, the whole...
It's like the catalyst.
Yeah, without him, we're not where we are now. So, I mean, he's still important. He's just, you know, he's sort of bowed out at this point. Like, his part's done.
His destiny is written in stone, you know, like, this is where he's going, and that's where he went, and now we're here. So, I guess to keep the ball rolling and to just get to the elephant in the room, as I just mentioned with Yukito, his fate is set in stone, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And he goes where he goes, and we're continuing past that point, and he's done his job.
Yeah.
So, now we have to look at Misuzu. And we all know where she winds up.
Mm-hmm. Oh my God.
So what do y'all think? What do y'all think?
I am so happy. Like, so sad, but so happy that they did it like this. Because I'm coming from a perspective that's played all the other key games in anime and stuff. But every key game, like most of them, they have this idea of they need to wrap things up in a very neat ending where everyone's happy. And, you know, often they have the opportunity to go with a really sad ending and they don't take it for whatever reason. Maybe they're afraid of alienating their audience. But here they're like, nope, Misuzu dies, that's it. She's not getting, like, magically resurrected, you know. She doesn't overcome the curse. It gets her. And it's like, oh my God. I wasn't really expecting it, but I'm so glad they went that route.
I'm very happy that they went that route too, because I feel like it was always headed that way. Like, I always felt like they were trying to make a statement here, and I feel like that statement just wouldn't have been as anywhere near as impactful if they didn't do this VN as they did. If Maida didn't choose this route, then a large majority of the message that I receive from this VN would just not be there.
I just have so much respect for her.
It goes back to, just like you said way before about the sappy ending, that this ending the way it does, it's like a more modernized Romeo and Juliet. Like, it's so romantic how it reaches its end, and those who are ended by it are just content with that. They're like, yep, this is it.
Yeah.
If nothing else will happen, then this will happen, and we will be fine with it. It reminds me of dinosaurs. I brought this point up whenever we did the Misuzu route, how Misuzu says the dinosaurs are so romantic because they have met their end. And that's the exact same way I feel right here.
I was so happy, because just like reading it, like, I'm just wondering how they're going to end it with that final scene, and she's taking the steps, and it's like, this is my destination, like, I'm done. And I'm like, oh my god, you did it, Misuzu, no! I was so, like, happy and sad at the same time. It's like, oh my god, like, they're not, the destination isn't overcoming the curse. It's about finding happiness with the time you have left. And I'm like, so good.
Being
so
content
good.
With the time that you had.
Yeah.
Well, I was
like, Haruka was always
telling I've already had all the happy moments, I think she said. Yeah. It's like,
Haruka's like, no, we're just getting started. And she's like, no, it's been going on forever. Here we are.
This is the end.
I have all I need.
I was happy with it, because the way I was looking at it is, if it had that nice bow tied on the end, if the final scene had been, you know, Yukito and Misuzu walking away in the sunset on the beach or something.
Yeah.
It would have felt to me like it would have cheapened the ending, and it would have cheapened everything that led up to the ending. Because if you think about it, what led to this point, all the way back from Summer, we've had 1,000 years of generations of these family that have basically sacrificed their lives. Not, you know, killing themselves, but sacrificed. They've dedicated their lives to this purpose of pursuing this girl in the sky. And, you know, they made this conscious sacrifice. We're going to give up our own will in life and pursue her, to find her. And finally we get to Yukito, who's found her and has seemingly found his way to help her to break this curse. It just would have felt like, you know, finally we've reached this point and we get this final big sacrifice from Yukito and Misuzu, who ultimately give up their lives, literally this time, and the curse is broken. Whereas if, you know, they had just said, okay, now the curse is broken, everybody lived happily ever after, it would have felt like, okay, what, you know, what was all the rest of it for? And so, you know, I was really happy with the way that it ended.
It's all about sacrifice.
It's the final step, and in the final step, you gotta put your foot down. Like, it's, this entire visual novel has just, the entire story is always giving me this idea of, in the face of inevitability, we're going to do what we want and we're going to be satisfied with it. And I feel like if there was no negative aspect here, then what's the point?
And the way that Haruko bounces back from it, like, I cried for like weeks after that, just every day. But now, like, I'm moving on with my life. You know, Misuzu taught me, you know, the value of living, basically. And that that she wants to teach others that happiness by being a school teacher was a really nice message.
Oh, yes. I love that, how whenever he mentioned how her career or something was doing, she was like, oh, you know, that part of my life is done now, or I don't need that part of my life anymore. I've moved
on.
Yeah,
exactly.
She's like, now, you know, I've rededicated my life to something that I want to do.
That CG at the end where she's just, like, smiling at Sora, though, she just looks so content, you know? Like, there's definitely a hint of sadness, but she just feels like such an enriched person compared to the Haruko we knew at the start.
What's life without sadness, you know? Like, it's part of our existence.
Yeah, that's what makes us, really. You can't grow without that. it's so good. Did you guys cry?
Yes, both times.
I cried like a baby.
I
cried every time.
Here's the thing. I came close to crying during my first reading, but during the second reading, I started shedding tears.
Oh, yeah.
It's like, it's strange that it felt so much more powerful during the second reading. It's like...
Yeah.
It was definitely more powerful my second time as well. I think it's because at that moment you've whenever you first see it, it's just kind of like happening, but then the second time you see it, you now have full realization of what this moment means.
Oh man, I can talk to you about other key games that do that for me.
See, I can get behind that, because while, you know, it never made me cry as it was going through it, but there was one moment in particular that it hit like a sledgehammer, and that was whenever Misuzu, she's talking to Sora, and she's talking about, oh, I'm going to go, you know, it's the last day of school, I'm going to go invite all my friends, and we're going to hang out for summer, and then she comes back out, and she's like, well, nobody wants to, and, you know, she's on the verge of tears. Like, that really impacted me, because you've already played through Dream, and you've seen Misuzu from Yukito's perspective, and all you get from her there is, oh, well, I don't have any friends, ni-ha-ha, I'll just play by myself. It's like, oh, okay, she doesn't seem to mind it that much. And now you see how much she really did mind it, how much it really affected her that, hey, I don't have any friends, I have nobody to play with. That just, you know, it sort of that rereading it from Dream to Air, it just added that extra punch behind it whenever it came to it.
Eru doesn't fucking let up with its feels. I hate to use that word, but all right, emotions. But just the idea that every freaking other scene is, I'm nearly crying. I only cried at the very end, but I was on the verge the entire time. Like, the scene where Haruko comes back after a business trip, it's like, I was just like ready to cry from happiness. It's just...
Oh, when she gets the drink?
Yeah.
So stop talking to yourself and just pick one already.
So, oh my god, like... Our hero has returned. Not the hero we expected, but the hero we all wanted.
So speaking of Haruko, do we want to talk about Haruko and how amazing she is again? This character is outstanding!
Like, we really picked up on how great she was in the common route. And I'm so glad that she ended up becoming, like, the almost the protagonist of this route, really.
Yeah.
Well, she was. She ended up being the partner to Misuzu in the end. You know what I mean? Like,
well, she gets that.
When Yukito left, then she came back and realized her responsibility, and she's like, "From this day forward, we will be happy together."
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, she gets that. She gets a redemption even from Dream. That, you know, even though it shouldn't have been a redemption, because, you know, when you're reading through Dream. I mean, through Misuzu and Dream, and you get to the end of it, just all of a sudden she's like, oh, business trip, I'm going, I'm gone, take care of Misuzu, see you later. And Yukito's like, hey, don't you know what's going on? You can't leave her like this. And she's like, no, I gotta go. And you're sort of like, gee, okay, she's given up on her. You know, what a jerk, she's finally given up or whatever. And then, you know, now in Air, all of a sudden you see from Sora's perspective, this is, you know, the reason she's gone is for Misuzu's sake, and it's just like, yes, she's who we thought she was.
That brings so up that brings up an interesting point, because it really shows how much influence Sora has on these characters, because even though he keeps saying, I can't do anything, I can't do anything, in reality he's the best thing that he's doing at that moment is just being there to hear out what these characters are thinking about.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's good.
That's good.
It makes me think about whenever somebody is having, like, such a struggle in their life.
And they need, like, somebody to conform to.
Yeah. Sometimes it doesn't even, like... I've been in that situation, too, where I'm just so furious. But, like, it doesn't matter who I'm talking to, and they don't need to say anything back. I just need someone to talk to. Like, it's very simple. It's like... You can say whatever you want, but I just need to let this out. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just, Sora, sometimes you just... Not even someone there to listen. Sometimes you just want someone there.
But you know what's interesting is that Sora's listening. He's quite an intelligent little bird, and he's listening to everything everyone's saying. He may not fully understand, but part of him must. You know what I feel is like? It's like he is taking everyone's... dreams and memories and wishes and all that, and just he's retaining everything. He's like a chronicler, you know, recording this little piece of history to return it to the sky, as Haruko puts at the end, you know.
Yeah,
isn't that interesting to think about? And that's our perspective as the reader, too. You know? We get this, so like, cool. This broad perspective on everything that's going on in this little town right now. Really cool. Thanks for bringing that up, Oz. That tied in well.
So, since we're talking about Haruko, I wanted to talk about a character that I would say, very unpopular opinion coming up. Maybe some people will agree with me. About a character that's rather comparable to Haruko. Perhaps for different reasons, perhaps for more negative reasons. But I wanted to talk about Keisuke a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
Haruko comes to this realization that she wants to pick up this, like, the pieces of this life that has been around her, and be with Misuzu, and be the mother that she knows she can be, or something along those lines. And the most interesting thing here is that she has been forcibly distant for 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Now let's look to Keisuke. He's lived a certain life for 10 years, and now he's trying to pick up the pieces. And the difference here is, like, obviously Haruko has still been there. So she's kind of on better ground here. Like, she has the capability of continuing and continuing this life with Misuzu that has always just kind of been there. And even as Misuzu says, like, ever since, you know, 10 years ago or whenever, when they went to the festival, like, that family has always been there. They've always loved one another. Like, they are truly mother and daughter. But as Haruko says to Keisuke, whenever he's just kind of like, you know, you're good for this, you're better for this, she says, no, I'm no better. She even realizes it. She says, she knows that now, exactly how Keisuke feels.
Yeah.
She says, I was about to hand her over to you and lose someone I love, just like you did to me, when you handed Misuzu to me and then left. So, now that she understands that, she's willing to do whatever it takes to not lose it herself. To not do as he did. And so I felt like that was a really important distinction.
Keisuke is the bad ending.
He's the bad ending protagonist.
Yeah. Pretty much. Like, a lot of people hate this guy. Like, I saw in the topic, like, yeah, he's a dick. Just full stop. It's like,
and I mean, he is. He kind of is. But, I mean, like, still, you can understand why he is the way he is, and even Haruko
can. There's more to it.
Yeah, and it's very important that you realize why that is.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting to look at the two of them, Keisuke and Haruko, because if you sort of look at it, they're two people, and it's kind of fun to compare and contrast them, but to look at them like this, they're two people that are heading in the same destination, but they're heading at it from two different directions. You've got Haruko, mm-hmm. who started out as a stranger. You know, she had no connections to Misuzu, and all of a sudden she's heading towards, she wants to become this parental figure. She wants to become a mother to Misuzu. Mm-hmm. And we've got Keisuke, who started on the opposite end of the spectrum, started out as a parent, but all of a sudden became a stranger. And now he's starting to come back, and he's trying to become more of that parental figure. He's trying to become the father again, and they sort of meet in the middle eventually. And I think mm-hmm. that's sort of why they have this connection that you see there in that epilogue, where they sort of, you know, you sort of get this vibe that they get along pretty well. And I think that's why they've traveled the same journey, just on different paths, pretty much.
Yeah, and Haruko, yes. Like, it's almost like Keisuke is a step ahead. Like, he's the bad end because he's the Haruko that gives up on Misuzu. And he's trying to come back, but he's already made his choice and he's gone down that road, so he cannot come back. But Haruko yeah. still has that opportunity. So they're kind of like, Haruko is where he was whenever Misuzu was like 7 or 8 or whatever.
Yeah.
So, like,
yeah.
You can understand why he ran away, because Haruko was going to run away. And that idea was there. And even Misuzu and Yukito both pick up the exact same understanding that Keisuke did. That sometime we just have to do this. We have to be separate. Just as Haruko picks up the idea of them being together and refuting the whole let's stay separate and stuff, that's right when Misuzu is like, I'm not going to be nice to you anymore.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just... it's painful.
It's just like, I didn't want that to be viewed as, like, the... oh, this guy's just a dick, let's leave it at that. Like, I wanted to bring it up and, like, explain that there's a very important purpose to this and why he is the way he is, because that is... that's the path that they're heading down. You don't want to become the Keisuke and be coming back to something and regretting what you did before.
No, absolutely.
You want to keep thinking forward.
I'm very glad you brought that up. Like, you put it very nicely. I'm not sure what to add, man. Like, that's pretty much it. He's the bad ending, and brings a lot of reality to the story. I'm just thinking that the dads in this series get the really short end of the stick.
Well, it was hard for me thinking about Keisuke because, you know, it all comes down to a little bit of if you want to believe him or not, because you start looking at the reason and...
yeah.
And then you start wondering, well, was it... can you really say he abandoned her? Because, you know, he says the reason was because she had problems being around people, making connections with people, and he lives in this large city where there's nothing but people, and that's the reason he sent her out to this small town, because mm-hmm. he felt legitimately that... hey, this will help her out. There's less people. She can get more, you know, close to just individuals instead of large groups of people. Which, if you take it from that, you know, that he looks like a caring father. And then at the same time, you can say, well, then why did he take himself completely out of her life? Why was there no connection between him and her other than, you know, we see him, he buys her a birthday cake, but he doesn't even give it to her himself. He sends it by way of Yukito.
And that so, says so much.
The exact same thing.
Yeah,
does the exact same thing, wanting to buy her a present and then doesn't give it to her, and then we have to thank little Sora for that. That's why I say that it's very important to just like, yes, you can kind of like, not exactly sympathize. You don't want to sympathize with him because you have to acknowledge the fact that he made the incorrect choice and he wound up down the bad path, and that's part of his life. He has to accept that as well.
Exactly.
It's very important that you realize. And the fact that he's there is important because it's, yeah, it's explaining that. It's, see, you don't be a Keisuke. You know what I mean? Like,
it's just, I guess I sort of, you know, I sort of feel bad for him because, you know, you see him as sort of that bad character, but he's sort of that tragic character that you can see he made the wrong choice, but you can see why he made the wrong choice. And like you said, mm-hmm. you don't really sympathize with him, but you can almost kind of understand him a little bit to understand, you know, he's not just this heartless jerk that said, oh, I'm done with this.
Doesn't this go back to Minagi's dad and the talk we had about
That's
him?
That's exactly what I was thinking about.
Just dads in this series, man, like, except for Ryuya, I guess, like, he's probably the only good one. Led a, like, I guess a noble life, you could say.
I was saying, you can say that, but he wasn't around for his kid either.
Actually,
yeah, that's true.
And I suppose with that, everything comes together with the beach scene, where, so, it's established at a point that Misuzu has to lose her memories at some point, and she does. And now she has absolutely no distinction between Haruko or Keisuke. They're both strangers.
Yeah. She kind of, like, regressed to when she was a young kid.
So, like a little baby not knowing who is who, she's forced into a situation where she has to pick either to go with her true father or to go with this adopted mother.
Mm-hmm.
And Haruko pleads for three days of spending time with Misuzu. Cool. And during this time, Haruko starts to open up a lot. Like, a lot. She starts being more honest with herself. And with Misuzu. She doesn't cut corners. She tries to care for her as much as possible in order to give her a good impression.
Mm-hmm.
And during this time, Haruko also starts feeling really, really repentant about things. She feels like she isn't really a good mother, She never really made the right choices.
Man, she experiences, like, the ups and downs of being a mother in, like, those 3 days. Like, holy crap.
It's like she's... It's really interesting because, like, you say repentive. It's like she starts asking all of these questions. Like, she's always asking for questions, and she says it in a way that she's trying to, like... It's like she's looking for something to blame.
Yeah.
But as a result of what the curse is, there's no one to blame. It's not her fault. Mm-hmm. It's not Keisuke's fault. It's not Misuzu's fault. It's just fate.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, that's how life is, man. Like, if someone gets into, like, an accident or something, you're always trying to think of who to blame. Is it God's fault? Is it my fault because I didn't tell them to do this instead? Or is it their fault for deciding to go a different route than normal? It's nobody's fault. It's just life, man. It's fate. Like, this is how it happens.
It's karma.
Yeah. So, eventually everything collides to a point where she decides to, where Haruko, the day comes, and Haruko decides to take her to the beach for her final request. Misuzu's asleep, and she starts by, pouring out her last thoughts to Misuzu. She feels sorry that she didn't spend enough time with her, and she starts to feel more confident that Keisuke would be a much better parent than she would. Mm-hmm. And she gives him to Keisuke, and tells him that she's done what she can, there's nothing else for her to do, and the rest is in his hands. And then Misuzu wakes up, and she's freaking out. She's like, "What's going on?"
And then, this is an amazing scene, by the
way.
Because you're seeing it from,
then,
like, Haruko and Yukito's perspective.
And then she starts standing up, something that she shouldn't be able to do. And she starts walking back over and calling, "Mama, Mama." So, in the end, guess who Misuzu ended up choosing?
Yeah. Isn't it interesting that she recalled everything at this pivotal moment? Why do you think that would be?
It's very interesting.
Why would you think that would be?
Well, maybe it's because they're on the beach.
Okay, something just sort of to fit this in right before we reach our little halfway point. Something that I found interesting, and I was thinking about, just thinking of how much symbolism there is in AIR and how everything seems to mean something and it's never really there accidentally. I got thinking about, you know, what's the big main focus that happens in AIR that you notice right off is that all of a sudden we're the player. It's a crow. We're seeing it from a crow's perspective. So I was wondering, why a crow? Out of anything that could have been, why are we specifically a crow at this point?
Because cool stuff.
Because cool stuff that Biz knows because he's read my notes. But, I have
a few things to say about that too, but I'll keep it.
Oh, okay. Well, I'll just, like, I sort of looked into it, and I've got an idea of an answer that, you know, I thought it was cool. But I started looking into, you know, crows and the meaning of crows and, you know, sort of the symbolism that's around them. And the first thing I noticed is that a lot of cultures sort of revere crows as being these highly intelligent animals, and they see them as, like, the keepers of wisdom and knowledge. And, you know, that I got to thinking, well, that ties in all of a sudden to our winged ones who are in this world, who are also our keepers of wisdom. You know, they pass on the world's knowledge. And so that was an interesting tie-in. And then, you know, you get to looking, and even throughout the route, it gets pointed out that, you know, Sora's this crow, and it's like, oh, you know, that's so creepy. You know, that they remind you of death, and, you know, you don't want to be walking around with a crow because of that, because people are going to look at you weird. Mm-hmm. Well, crows are commonly tied into death, but there's a little bit of a deeper meaning behind that. A lot of cultures look at crows, and the reason they're tied into death is you'll see them eating carrion, you know, these dead corpses and everything. Well, these cultures say that crows are really strong as far as
like spiritual animals, because what they do is they take the souls of those who have departed and they become basically their ferrymen to the other world. So they carry human souls to the afterlife. Mm-hmm. And so I was thinking, all of a sudden we have Yukito, who supposedly his soul hasn't been put into this doll, and now it's free. So a crow has picked it up, and that's why all of a sudden now Sora is this crow, and Yukito finds himself inside of this crow, is because mm-hmm. they had sort of that predisposition towards, you know, they're the ones that are ferrying these souls back and forth, and, you know, it sort of just picked up Yukito, and Yukito took over. So that was sort of the answer I came to, but it seemed like a cool question to me because, you know, it didn't feel really like it was an accident that, you know, they didn't just pull it off the top of their head. Hey, let's make him a crow. Just, that seems cool.
No, definitely not. I didn't know a lot about the symbolism of crows, but that's very interesting.
Yeah. That's like I said earlier, it's the coolest thing that they chose. You know, he's not just a bird, he's a crow. And like I said, there's very, very cool symbolism in it, and that's definitely part of it, but I've got even more later.
Oh, yeah. And I think we're going to dive into our mid-episode break right now. So, take a listen to this song I prepared, and we'll be back in 5 minutes. You can pause the recording, whatever you want, and we'll see you soon. Welcome back. Things are about to get very interesting because everybody's been holding out for their big, huge points at the end, and now we're going to kind of throw them all in the wok and see what comes out. And I'd just like to open by responding to Bowie's earlier point about Sora and the idea that the idea of why did he become a crow? And I did a lot of research because something that keeps coming up in AIR is these references to Buddhism. Like, it becomes really apparent in Summer with all the Japanese Buddhism going around, like the monks and stuff.
Warrior monks.
But yeah. And but Buddhism is... the Buddhist faith is very central to everything that is AIR. Like, concepts of, like, Buddhist mythology and cosmology just keep coming up. One of the most obvious ones is going to be rebirth. We usually call it reincarnation, but that's not the term they like to use in Buddhism. They prefer rebirth because, as opposed to Hinduism, rebirth doesn't imply that everybody has a soul. Actually, I think it's kind of against that. There's no, like, soul that transfers over after death. It's more like everything that you did, your memories, your experiences, and your karma get transferred from one body to another after death in the process they call rebirth. And I specifically say karma, but the word that means is very different in Buddhism to as we conventionally think of it, like, oh, you do good things and good things will happen to you. It's not like that. Karma is basically a fancy way of describing at least the spiritual layer of cause and effect. Things happen and often there's no justice to it. It's completely impartial. Bad things happen to good people as a result of things that happened in the past. Like, innocent people can suffer from things that have nothing to do with them. So yeah, I did some research and it actually led me to this little webpage by... well, it wasn't by, it's on Funblog. But it was linked to by beneaththetangles.com, our friends. It keeps coming back to them, so credit to them for finding this, and I'll link to the article in the description of the video on cosmaster.org. But basically, yes, just going into all these concepts of Buddhism in anime, and some of the principles there. Like I just mentioned karma, how it's just like, it's completely indiscriminate. And that made me think about the curse, you know. It was obviously caused by malicious intent by the monks trying to imprison Kana, but in the end, like, the effects have nothing to do with what's right or wrong. It's just something that happened, and that keeps carrying through all the different rebirths of Kana and all the different versions of her. So there's also... there's a lot of ideas, but one of the concepts of rebirth is that every time you're reborn, it can be in... like, there's all these different worlds in Buddhist cosmology. you could kind of think of them as like layers or phases of our world. And the two we're aware of are humans and animals. Animals being slightly below us. And depending on what world you get born into, well, what world you get born into depends on your karma. So what you've done in your life will determine what kind of form you get born into in the next life. And I was thinking, animals, eh? Yukito, at the end of his journey in Misuzu Route, he disappears, and in Air Route, we're introduced to a new character, Sora, which it is heavily implied is a rebirth of Yukito. And the reason people usually get turned into animals after rebirth is because of... It was just, I don't know if it was mentioned in this article, but I've just done a lot of research all around. This idea of ignorance. Like, humans who don't do anything with their life, and they just live on, like, base desires, and they fail to, like, search for anything greater. They end up as animals. And it makes me think, like, isn't that how Yukito lived most of his life? He was just, like, kind of wandering around without any sort of goal. And he didn't understand what he had to do yet at that point until the very end when it was too late. And he was burdened by that. Like, in the end, that karma transferred over to his next life where he's reborn as a crow. And that's the consequence of everything that's done. Like, he complains, like, is this world so cruel that, like, I try to be with Misuzu and I just end up as a bird? But while that's also like a direct cause, according to Buddhism, of his actions in his past life. We've also brought up how it ended up being to his benefit in some ways, because of what a crow is, and having wings and all that. There's so much you could go into about this Buddhism, but another thing, another concept that keeps coming up is suffering. So I'm just going to quote the article. In the Buddhist view, suffering is a subjective phenomenon that is caused by the mind's natural tendency to form attachments and aversions. If you desire something, then you suffer because you did not possess it. Even if you acquire the thing you love, you will suffer since you must eventually lose it, since everything in this world is transient and ephemeral. This idea that to live is to suffer because we will eventually lose everything we have. You know? Isn't that so relevant to Air?
Yeah, it sounds pretty... It's pretty accurate.
And it just goes back to, you know, Misuzu's curse. Like, she's always suffering because, you know, this... She's, like, attached to the world. She's attached to people. And, you know, she wants to form relationships with others, but she can't. And that's the cause of her suffering. And, I don't know, it's just...
Didn't they specify that those monks... Did they specify that they were Buddhist monks?
Yes.
Well, isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
I mean, it's definitely interesting. And I could say I've learned quite a bit there. I know I've heard about those few things, like the humans and animals and kind of the different worlds thing, but... One point that I definitely want to focus on is that you mentioned that the fact that he does become a crow is actually kind of, like, beneficial. And him becoming a crow, whenever you think about what a crow is in symbolism here, like, at least in Japanese culture, it's almost like an upgrade. You know what I mean? It's almost like he's being rewarded because he's becoming something that's actually, like, more powerful, I guess.
Maybe in the eyes of, like, karma, this is meant to be, like, some sort of punishment, but it ends up being to his benefit at the same time, so it's kind of like a weird twist of fate.
You could almost view it as, like, kind of like a loophole to the Buddhist thing. Like, it's like they didn't plan that one out. Like, what if he becomes a crow? Oh, no!
One thing that I did find interesting, though, is that they say here, and to eliminate suffering, you must avoid attachments and aversions. And how did Misuzu overcome the curse? Is, I feel like it's because she was able to say goodbye. It's probably the first time any of the girls have been able to do this, is to be able to live with a smile without regret, knowing that you've spent your life to its full. And that you can leave in peace.
Okay, that makes a lot more sense then. Because that was kind of my problem with it before was I was just kind of like, okay, that's interesting, but what is there to gain? That kind of wraps it up much nicer.
It's like she almost achieved enlightenment at the very end. In a weird way.
Let me ask you a question. If we're looking at it from this idea of he was, you know, this idea of Buddhist rebirth into a crow, does that mean that Yukito died that night whenever, right before Misuzu woke up again? And then was reborn into the crow?
It's weird that he happened to die in that particular way, if you want to call that dying.
Well,
same thing happened to his mother, and we never saw his mother again, remember?
Well, the reason I bring that up is because I feel like AIR proves to us that he does end up inside the puppet, and I don't really think he really died there as much as he moved into the puppet the same way his mother did. And the reason I say that is because at the very beginning of AIR, you have a choice, and you can run headfirst into a bad end at full speed really quick. And if you choose not to follow Misuzu, you end up on a bad end right off the bat. And right after that, whenever you don't follow Misuzu, Sora looks to the sky and he starts remembering things. And we know this is, you know, at this point we know Sora is Yukito pretty much at this point. And one of the things he starts thinking about is, and going back again to the Misuzu podcast, we sort of threw around the idea that his mother went into the puppet at the time when she disappeared. That was sort of, you know, an idea we threw around of what happened to her, why he disappeared. And so once you get to that bad end and Sora is standing there thinking about all these things, it says these lines. He says, "I'm sure I was sleeping beside my mother until a moment ago in a place that had always been warm and comforting." So I feel like that's saying that just before he became Sora, he was still inside the puppet with his mother, because he says he was beside his mother and it was a place that's been warm and comforting. You know, we've talked about the puppet is this placeholder of all these hopes and dreams of all these people that have handed it down. So that would be a place of hope and, you know, warmth and comfort for him.
Also, this is actually something that I did take note of, is that he doesn't remember anything in particular whenever you first set foot into being Sora. He doesn't remember anything particular, but the first thing that he remembers is that he remembers the word mom. He remembers, like, mothers. And he remembers the fact that a mother is something that teaches you things. Like, that's the first thing he remembers, is the idea of a mother.
Yeah.
Maybe that's the thing he retained from his past life. Because he did say he doesn't have a mother as a crow, didn't he? I don't know, that's like, you can interpret that any number of ways, much like anything in this route. Very interesting. I didn't pick up on them, that it might be the fact that, you know, yeah, he was like with his mother and the doll, and so that's kind of where he went to rest. It's very, very mysterious.
It's almost like it could be this and also this. It's like a mix of things, really, you know?
Mm-hmm. You're going to get a lot of that in this episode.
Yeah, I was about to say, you know, that's this route in a nutshell. It's a little of this, a little of that.
There's a lot of different influences that go into this, and I feel like it's almost as if you could say, like, the Buddhist curse and that idea is it's created by the influence of the Buddhist belief. And, like, that is something that they created, and it may be true to them, and it's true to them because that's how, you know, they make their curses and stuff. Like, it all just kind of moves that way. But that it's not to say that these other existences, like believing in the winged ones or having these other beliefs, are incorrect. They could actually both be correct.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you could view it as, well, way back in the day, you know, Jesus and Muhammad were homies, you know what I mean? Like, it's maybe everyone's a little right and a little wrong. You know, it's very interesting. Like, it's staying safe. It's like AIR or Maida doesn't want to present you one factual religion. He wants to keep all of that ambiguous so that you can apply it to just about anything. Mm-hmm. As long as you can retain that moral importance.
Like you were saying before about the dinosaur being a god.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's interesting. Did you want to talk a little bit about this? So we've got some discussion happening on the forum about, like, how timelines work. It got a little bit off, like, tangential, but...
A little?
But it's still worth mentioning is this whole idea of what is the dream arc and how does that relate to AIR? Personally, I was hoping Biz had some thoughts on this.
I have quite a few thoughts, and if you want me to jump right on in, then I most certainly will.
That might be a good time, yeah.
Alrighty. Well, so, there are interesting pieces of this route that, like, it's kind of hard to say it's this way or that way, and how it's written. Like, is the dream route, or the dream routes within it, whatever you want to call it, are those all separate instances? Like, obviously they're their own story, sure, but like, are they separate realities? Is dream and Misuzu route, obviously whenever we become Sora, we clearly see that Yukito is someone that exists. Like, because we've turned into Sora does not mean that Yukito disappears. He's still there and he still completes his purpose. Mm-hmm. Even if he's not, or he may still be at the same time, the same kind of, mind that Sora is. So, you know, it brings up the question of, did we move over to, like, a different world line here, where Yukito is no longer this person? Well, I don't think that's true, because he clearly still disappears to create where we are. And there's also, the idea that Yukito is... I feel like just the idea that Yukito is still there. Simply, it puts it very straightforward in my perspective that we're still in the same world, just from a different viewpoint.
But we didn't see Sora in the dream arc.
That is where I'm kind of confused.
well, I
like,
feel like...
We don't see Sora, even if he is hinted at a little bit. Like, there was the interesting point where Yukito walks into Misuzu's room and he hears the flapping of wings. Maybe that was Sora taking off. You know, like, there's, like, these little hints. But it's not really concrete. So, it's almost as if we're still in the same thing, but now we've been added. And we're not actually changing, we're not changing worlds here, we're just kind of moving back. As Yukito says, he turns back the clock, right? Mm-hmm. Turns back the clock, and now we're Sora, right? Like, I don't feel like we're moving back the line here, but we're not jumping over to another one. So I feel like it's very important that they made that point.
I just think it's really weird that we could, like, not see Sora, because he does have, like, an influence on the story. Like, he's there. Like, mm-hmm. He's on Misuzu's shoulder every time, and we never see her in the CGs or anything. It's like...
It's very strange.
Very hard to explain away.
Well,
and there are other things to bring up here where, like, I can't particularly say whether, like, is it, like, some sort... Was it, like, a slip-up in writing, you know? Like, it's very hard to tell, like... Maybe the idea of Sora came at a later point in design. I don't know. It's hard for me to say. Thinking about what it is that Sora does, you could almost view it as, you know, a different world thing. Because it's like he's just kind of this one instance in time that you see, and then once it's gone, it's gone. Because, like, one thing that I thought was interesting was... One of the very final CGs with the children on the beach, they look at Misuzu and Yukito sitting on the seawall, and we live that exact same experience as Sora on the seawall, so we know he's there. But in that CG, after everything is said and done, in that CG, Sora is not there. You don't see him in the CG. So.
I didn't notice that.
If we want to move even further into this, I like to think about the idea of crows again, and how when you look into, like, the Yatagarasu symbolism, I love crows, by the way, when you look into that symbolism, he is a precious winged being. He's very important. Crows are to be revered as messengers of the gods. Mm-hmm. And Sora comes into this world. He sees this experience, and he takes all of these dreams, as you said earlier. He's pulling in these dreams and these hopes and all these things. He's viewing this as it happens. It's very important that he is there to witness these things happening.
Mm-hmm.
He witnesses these happy memories. And it comes back around at the very end, whenever he talks to Haruko, and she tells him, go home and return to the sky. Bring mm-hmm. the hopes and dreams to the sky and to the heavens.
Mm-hmm.
When you think about Sora as the messenger of the gods, he's coming, he's going back to the sky and back to home, and he specifically says, let's go home.
He does say,
let's go.
He
brings all of those dreams back up to the sky, back to where he belongs. Sora's destiny is to reach his home in flight, and he knows that. He's like, it's going to be sad because I'm going to be alone, but that's where I'm going to be. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So, in completing that, he no longer exists, and then we go back into this next world line where we see this scene yet again, and he's no longer there.
On world lines, this actually, I'm not 100% certain on this, but I think that it kind of plays into Buddhism again, because there's this idea of Buddhism of, I think that's called the Wheel of Time, this idea that time is very long, very old, but it runs in a circle. It's a cycle. And it ends with the universe's destruction and begins with its rebirth. And every time, it's not exactly the same. It's very similar, but it's slightly different each time. Maybe you could interpret that as just different world lines going, you know, as the world gets...
It ends, but it comes universe, back and just kind of...
Yeah.
It overwrites itself, you know?
Yeah, exactly. It's like... And so maybe in one iteration we have Sora, in the next we don't. You know what I mean? It's kind of like the world kind of rewriting itself over and over. That might be one way to think about it. The whole way I thought about, like, the differences between dream and air is simply that Sora is a fixed point. He exists in the world as a rebirth of Yugito. But the difference being is that at the very start, he made the choice to follow Misuzu instead of just doing his own thing. I think that's the pivotal point where mm-hmm. Air Root becomes different from Dream.
Because it happens in Dream. Like, Misuzu runs up to the bird and it runs away. It's almost like that's the exact same point where we're kind of starting. Like, it's very interesting.
Bit of poor writing there, because, like, the dates are a little bit wrong, because that's before
he's... Yeah, that's why I say, like, I feel like there are just a little bit of, kind of, like, mishaps and incongruity, but I don't think that it's entirely wrong. Or it's exactly as you say, where it's this kind of overwritten existence, like we're moving into a new cycle and moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, thinking about the curse... An important distinction between Yukito and Sora is obviously Sora is a crow, and he returns to the sky because he's bringing those happy memories to the sky, and guess who's up there? Kana! And what was she waiting for? Her happy memories.
Yeah, that's true. And that's what all the winged ones have been waiting for. They've been hoping that at the very end we can at least see happy memories. There's a lot here. There's so much I can go on about. There's like the idea, like in Buddhism, we have like the tenin, like Bowie brought up earlier. They're like messengers of like the heavens who like bestow blessings upon the world. Like our tenin didn't have a musical instrument like they usually do in the mythology, but the idea is the same, you know, they're trying to make the world happy. Like we saw that in the final monologue. Can we talk about this now? The final little bit of just after Sora leaves, and he ends up going to the sky, we get this scene where it's a mother speaking to a child, and we get the same CD we saw at the very start of the game, and
it's a little different.
Yeah, is it?
Yeah, it's the same image, but the conversation's a little different.
No, but at the very start, just like, let me tell you a story, and then it cuts off and goes to the AIR logo.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I feel like it's like finally continuing that. Like, we usually think, oh, it's like Yukito and his mum, but in this case, it's clearly the winged beings talking to each other. And it makes me think of when Yabikuni was like telling kind of like the secrets of like the world and their history as the winged people and their responsibility. I feel like that's the conversation we're getting now, because we didn't get to hear it then. We just like heard like Ryuta like talking about it in like second person. I think like they wanted to censor it for us, because there's a lot of information dropped in that small little bit. They're talking about like how they're the winged ones are chroniclers and how they're like sending these messages to the heavens, like they're spending blessings, but they're also like retaining all the memories of the earth, I guess, to pass on to heaven or something like that. But they talk about the first memory of the earth, and it keeps coming up, like they've been around since basically the earth was created, and it kind of goes back to the Wheel of Time idea. But there's one thing many people I don't think noticed, is that when Sora like is going through the sky and the destination he reaches, we get a CG of the girl in the sky. But there's one thing that's odd about it, is there's fucking pterodactyls flying below her. And isn't that interesting? Because we go back to when Misuzu was having her nightmares and she's describing her dreams. Back in Misuzu route, we got like one of the last dreams she had was like talking with Aunt Maria in the forest and that. But this time, we start getting dreams we didn't see last time. One of them is that she's locked in a cage. And, you know, not a cage, she says she's in prison somewhere and she can't get out. And I thought, that didn't happen to Kana, did it?
Yeah, it did.
That happened to it.
Well, in a sense, like, she was pretty much locked on top of the mountain.
Yeah, I kind of viewed it as she was in that she was not a literal cage, but that's how Misuzu felt. How she felt.
I definitely didn't read it like that. I read it as much more literal. She was imprisoned somewhere. And the first image that brought to mind was Yabikuni, her mother. It's like, we know that the winged ones can pass on memories from one generation to the next, so why shouldn't it be possible that Misuzu's going back through time? Why shouldn't she be able to see the memories of the past winged ones? Do you remember what the last dream she saw was? The saddest dream in the whole world, is how she describes it. Is she was soaring through the sky, there was wings on her back, and there were dinosaurs with wings flying below her. The first memory of the Earth, the saddest memory of all, is prehistory. Back when the winged girl, was flying all alone. Why do you think that is the saddest memory?
I have no idea.
Since I was thinking about this, maybe it's just because she was all alone in the world for millions of years. That's pretty fucking sad to think about, I think. You know, this is like, we have like the idea of like Kana soaring through the sky, but this is a whole new level. You know what I mean? It's almost like it's imitating that sort of loneliness, that event where a girl was soaring through the sky for millions of years with no one to talk to and just, you know, watching. It's like
almost
that
like it's like a world without love, I guess is what you're kind of trying to say.
Yeah. Like, yeah, it's just, it's completely devoid of anything. It's just perfect isolation, I think, is terrifying to think about. Like, maybe it is romantic in a sense, but it's also like something that I wouldn't wish upon anybody. But you could even go deeper than that, and you could dig and say, maybe it's sad because if we go back even further, we go to a time when nothing existed, where the earth was just a rock, and before that, where the universe didn't exist. Like, I don't know, like, you could just interpret that sort of sadness of something that doesn't exist.
It's a world
yet.
Without a history. There's a world without experience.
It's incomprehensible, even. But, but she keeps saying how she
wants to keep memory.
She keeps wanting to go back in time because she wants to find the reason the girl in the sky is sad. And the end of her dream is that moment, soaring through the sky with the dinosaurs. It keeps coming back to that. It's the first memory. And I almost feel like because she saw that memory, she was able to overcome the curse. Because she keeps saying that she needs to see these dreams through to the end. And she did. And she was able to survive it. It's like she was able to move on from that sadness that's been passed down through the line for thousands and... No, not thousands, like billions of years. And she's able to face that reality and still retain her humanity, almost, you could say. Is proof that she's overcome the curse and she's been able to let go of that, you know, that attachment she has to that sad memory. Maybe I'm going too far with this, but I don't know. Like, that's what I got from it. I've kind of been ranting for a long time now, but it just comes back to this idea that the dinosaurs are so important. You know, they're not just
clearly
there for no reason.
Clearly, the only reason that Misuzu was the one who was able to break the curse here is because she saw dinosaurs, so she was immensely happy.
It's not the only reason, but I think at the end they say, the first memory of the Earth, my happy memories of you. It's like these two polar opposites, which the beginning and the end, and taking them all together is what lets the girl be happy in the end and escape from the curse. I feel like those...
I didn't really view that as connected to the curse personally, but it's interesting nonetheless.
I think if you reread it, you might see what I mean.
Well, it's actually sort of... Like, I've had a thought just since we've sort of been talking about it, and it's just sort of sparked something to me. Going back, barring your idea, talking about this idea of the Buddhist wheel of time, that when the world ends, it's where it begins again, is maybe... What if the idea, and thinking about why, if that first part, if that part right there is the saddest memory, what if on that wheel of time, what if the memories carry over? Even when time ends and begins, what if the memories carry over? And so we have this first winged being who has inherited the memories, and she's looking at the Earth that's just getting started and knows it's going to end, and knows how everything's going to end. And that's why it's the saddest memories. She knows, hey, I'm looking at these dinosaurs. They're all going to die. And you know, this Earth is going to end in certain ways. And so you just had this cycle of, hey, it's beginning again, but I know it's going to end.
Yeah. That's definitely another way of interpreting it. Because that's a thing that keeps coming up, this idea of like being able to have the strength to say, to let go, basically, but also to accept that death is inevitable. It's like, that's like the real challenge of all of our characters, is just accepting that fact and being able to smile at the end is what everybody hopes for.
Yeah, that's why it's like the whole point of Misuzu's death is like, that's why it's pointless otherwise, because a very important message is to always, like, regardless of the inevitability of the world ending, well, I'm gonna live happily through it anyways, and I'm going to continue to push my memories forward. Like, I'm going to take this happy memory, and I don't care what the world wants to say about it.
Well, that that touches on, you know, it's sort of a, I don't remember whose key point it is, but I remember reading it about, you know, how was the curse broken? What changed with Yukito and Misuzu? And I think we pretty much just pointed out exactly what it was, is Misuzu and Yukito both came to the point, especially Misuzu, where she just accepted, you know, hey, this curse, it's going to kill me. At, you know, period. And Yukito accepted, hey, this curse is going to kill her, and he came back anyway. Well, Misuzu accepts, hey, the curse is going to kill me, but I'm not going to let that, you know, rule what time I have left. I'm going to create these happy memories in spite of that and live up until the point, you know, live the time I've got, basically.
Yeah. It's powerful shit. I love it, though. It's like, I think it's Maida's favorite thing to write about.
It goes back to exactly what Haruko says. She says, more or less, I'm not sure if the quote is correct, but it's like, It's almost like the pinnacle of the VN for me. She says, "You taught me how to live with someone else, for someone else, even though I didn't deserve it. You showed me family, you showed me home, you showed me a thing to protect and something to become strong for, and we found happiness. We don't need luxuries, only each other."
Where was this from?
It's me, like, paraphrasing kind of what Haruko says when Misuzu dies. Like, what it kind of means.
Well, jumping off of that, I think it's about time that we brought up a recorded message that forum member Pepe has left for us. Take it away, Pepe.
Hi, everyone. I hope you're all enjoying recording the final podcast of the AIR Book Club. Now, I have a question for all you guys. What was up with that final scene of Air Out with the two kids on the beach? How did they know that Misuzu and Yukito were doomed to a sad fate? And what did they mean when they said that they will walk to the end of infinity? I hope you guys can discuss this well enough, because I honestly have absolutely no idea what to make of it. Cheers.
I guess we're going to eventually have to be getting to this beach scene.
Speaking of elephants in the room.
I'm sure quite a few people saw this scene and were just kind of like, what the fuck? Like, we're really able to kind of grasp what it might mean. And I'm sure a lot of people got quite a few different interpretations. But anyways, the boy on the beach says, whenever he's looking at Yukito and Misuzu, he says, you know, fate, thinking about the wheel. He says, they were given cruel days, while we were given a new beginning.
Yeah. I feel like this is where the Wheel of Time really comes into play with this final scene here. Like, a lot of people are complaining, like, how is this, like, it's in the past, we already saw this, but...
The Wheel of Time is a very, very good interpretation, because, like I said, I don't see it as a separate world line. I don't see it as, like, a different existence. I viewed it as going back to the beginning and moving forward yet again, like, but still being a continuous forward motion. Like, I don't feel like we break away from this world. So, like, I guess...
It's not like one thing is canon, one thing's not.
Yeah, what do you guys think that the beach scene, what was its purpose? What do you guys think? Aspie, you go first. Why did we see this?
The thing that occurred to me is that this is the scene that makes it perfectly clear that the curse ended. I think was its primary purpose.
Yes. I agree.
Because, you know, we have the boy who has a flash of inspiration and he remembers all the secrets of the universe, because I don't know. I still don't know who he is. I still haven't decided. You know, maybe he's Yukito, maybe he's Misuzu, maybe some people have said he's Ryuya. I think that was Bowie's point, wasn't it?
That was me.
We don't know. Like, he could be any of these characters, but the point is he's inherited memories from another time, another world.
I think the point is that he is our boy, or he is our first piece of significant other that is out to meet the girl before she meets her fate.
Yeah. But he's already seen everything that's happened. And he's like, he apologizes. You know, sorry that you have to put up with this cruel fate, but because you did,
And who's right next to him? What about the girl?
You know, what about the girl, man?
What about the girl?
Personally, like...
You don't think the girl is important?
I don't. But
wow.
Just,
that's interesting.
I don't know.
I would disagree. I feel like the girl is very important, because, I mean, look at the AIR logo. You see that girl? She's holding someone's hand and wearing that dress, and that's the exact same girl that's on the beach. I think she's pretty important.
But she doesn't say anything important. This just bugs me. It's just like, she's the normal kid.
It doesn't matter what she says. It's who she is.
And who do you think she is?
Who she's implied to be.
I think she's the first free and can she's the first free incarnation of the cursed girl. I think she's the first one that's going to be free to live a full life. That's who I think she is.
Maybe that's a good way of thinking about it. Because, like, if we think of the curse as inheriting all of the past burdens of the past lives, this is someone who has come out of it without any of that. She is completely innocent. She's untainted.
You have to remember that Misuzu still dies. It still ends. But what's next? What's after that one, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there's got to be the next one. And I think that we're looking at her right here.
The end.
And guess
where
she is? She's on the beach, which is she's on the beach with someone that she loves, the place she wants to go, and they're moving forward. Mm-hmm. But we're here already, so there's no bad future to worry about. It's done.
That's definitely what I felt they were trying to go with. It's just like, yeah, it's you can rest easy now, because even in some bizarre, twisted reality that we don't understand, they found a happy ending because of all the efforts of everyone that came before. You know, we still got our happy ending in the end. Even if we don't fully understand it, it is what it is.
Now, I want to take this and go on an adventure.
Oh, can I? You mind if I just
jump
in real quick before we move past that? Because, you know, you kept mentioning you felt like we were in the same vein, and this is eventually where I ended up too. And Aspie threw what I felt like the key word was inheritance. Because if you take the entire story and strip away basically names and logos, you know, don't think of it as Ryuya, don't think of it as Yukito and Sora, just think of it, like the way I started thinking of it is, this is a story of two people.
It's
a story of two people throughout the entire time. Mm-hmm. We have the seeker, and we have the one who is seeked. Yes. And so that's basically what this is. It's, you see these two roles, they're inherited from generation, 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 and this is just the next generation. It's just that, you know, now we've got, it's a little different inheritance because, you know, the girl who was inheriting the curse the entire time, all of a sudden the curse is broken. So now we get to see how this pair of people proceeds forward without, you know, that monkey on their back.
Mm-hmm. Is that all you had to say?
Yeah.
All right, cool. So, like I said, I wanted to take that and then go on an adventure with it. There was something
billions
that happened.
And billions of
There's
these.
Something that happened in a previous podcast that I thought was super interesting that Aspie said. And Aspie also asked me before, he said, "Hey man, I mean, as someone who's read this before, is there a different view that you had reading it a second time?" And let me tell you, boy, did I get a different interpretation the second time.
You've been holding out on me, boy.
This is exactly why. So, I'm going to say it right now. Disclaimer, I could be so wrong right now. I could be so incredibly wrong, and you're going to think I'm an idiot, but I think this is so cool.
I'm looking forward to this, because you've been hyping this up.
Aspie said in another podcast, or maybe it was Pepe, I don't know who it was. Somebody said this. They asked, would it be possible that Yukito met the previous girl at some point, because he had this memory, right, of meeting someone before, and so it was like, do you think he met the previous girl on his adventures? No, he didn't. You want to know who he did meet? The next one. Whoa. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that an interesting statement?
Whoa.
Throughout this entire visual novel, we've had multiple instances of this strange little side story that has come up multiple times.
Oh my god, I know where you're going with now, this
now. Now, let's look at Sora for a minute here. He has this scene, right, where he's chilling up by the shrine, and this other girl comes up with her mother. And there's a girl that's sick. Why is she so sick? And so they're there to pray for her to get better. And this girl's name is Micah. And aw shit, guess what her sister's name is, y'all. Her name is Saika. Isn't that interesting? Now, was this just a little story to make us feel better? I don't know. But it's very peculiar that there's this girl who's always getting sick all the time, and we don't know why she's getting sick. And they're trying to figure it out. Why isn't she getting better? Why isn't she getting better? But now, we look to the future, and we see these people on the beach. And she's this girl who's just kind of... You think, why are these kids chilling on this beach? Like, where are the parents, right? Well, Maybe the girl and the boy are a little rebellious and like to get away from where they're supposed to be. Which goes to Haruko, right, when she's talking about, oh, there's these two girls, this girl and this boy, and they're rebellious and stuff, and they're always going out and not doing what they're supposed to do. And well, in this scene, I think these are the same, this is the same girl, basically. I think the girl's Saika, straight up. And I think that Saika is the next step.
I want you to be right so bad, but I don't think you are.
The children are the next step of the curse. The girl reaches her goal before even reaching like this point in her life where she's doomed. They get to move to infinity where nothing's gonna stop them. It's these two small shadows start walking down a distant endless road. They keep walking onwards, unafraid of what awaits them. That's something I can't do because in my fate I'm gonna be doomed because I'm Yukito, I'm this bird, I'm gonna die. That's what Sora says. I'm doomed. It's something I cannot do, but they can. Why does he specify that the boy and the girl can do that?
We need to look at the scene at the end, and we need to determine if they have the same voice first. You don't
see
them.
I can tell you right now that they don't seem to. Yeah. And this is why I want to say that they're... I want to pray that this was just a mishap in production.
I see.
That they were like, we need another little girl. We need another little girl voice in this part. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, I just want to hope that that's what happened. Because I feel like all of these things are here. And for them to just be all these separate little stories doesn't make sense to me. There needs to be a connection there.
Yeah.
Why is she so the... She's the cover girl. She's the staple girl. The AIR logo is that girl.
Oh my god, like... I could crush your hopes right now and tell you that the anime is completely against that theory.
Who says the anime is right?
That's right. That's,
this is first.
That's what I'm getting at. Like, you're not wrong. Because it could be just a production mistake and, like, somebody up at Key didn't get that this is what Mina was getting at, you know what I mean?
Exactly.
Like, oh my god, I really want to agree with you. The evidence says otherwise, but if you look past it, and if you just think that maybe this was the intention, then the world's yours, man.
And honestly, who are we to let evidence get in the way of something cool?
Like, man, I think about Maida writing, and I just think about a story that everything is connected and tightly interwoven. I think about his purpose. And then whenever I see these little side stories that keep popping up, and people are like, that's pointless, that's not interesting. It's like, well, guess what? You have to see it. So it's gotta be important, man.
That's what I was saying about Saika. I reckon she's important,
it,
too.
The first time you saw it, we mentioned it, you're like, I didn't think it was that interesting. I thought it was cute and stuff, but I didn't feel like it was going anywhere. Well, I'm just like, damn it so is. Like, this has to be something here.
No, but I did say straight after that, but wait a second. There's got to be a reason for this.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Like, I really, really like that theory. Who am I to say it's wrong? Who's fucking the anime to say it's wrong?
Yeah. What else did they get
why
right?
Not?
Nothing.
Exactly.
I also want to say another really cool thing, actually. I know this is not really the way to segue off this, but I do love how when the boy leaves, the final thing he says is farewell, and then farewell song plays. Oh, yeah!
Oh.
He says they're able to say goodbye right from the beginning.
Yeah. Yeah, that, you know, saying... Yeah, being able to say goodbye, it's what it all comes down to, isn't it?
Yeah, and, like, it's so crazy, because, like, that was where I started, that was my first question, is this girl Saika? And has she always been the next one from the beginning? Because she's sick all the time, and I'm just like, well, if Sora can exist alongside Yukito, then I don't really see why she can't be. Like, I don't see how the next girl, this girl is apparently gonna die when she's really young, like, I don't see how it's impossible that the next one is already in the making, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. It's valid. Like, the only evidence against it in the VN is the voice. But mm-hmm. if you just... Yeah, you could just look at that and just be so, like, they got it wrong. That's my new headcanon. You know, goddamn it. This is my new headcanon.
You have to remember... You have to remember there's another thing about the voice acting, is that the voice acting didn't even exist in the beginning. It was added.
Oh, yeah! You're right.
Oh, okay. Here we go.
Oh, man. What do you think, Bob?
I think we need to send Pepe back to Baba for a little while with a new question.
But he wouldn't know. You gotta ask Maida about that. Oh, God.
That was my big thing, is no, I was just like, the cool question is, did Yukito meet the previous girl? Nah, man, he met the next one. I was so hyped when I wrote that down.
Oh, that's really cool. I'm gonna adopt that from now on. Fuck it. I don't care if it's right or wrong. That is too good.
It's right to us, and that's all that matters.
Yeah, I think that's what you need to take from this podcast, is... There ain't gonna be any absolute answers with AIR.
That's what I said before, man. Like, these kinds of messages, they aren't absolute. You mentioned the conversation between the two beings. You said that they were the winged ones.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I kind of viewed it as such, but the music changes and it cuts away from that image, right? And then it's just the text, and it's just talking directly to you. I viewed that message, and I don't have it written down, I probably should have, but I felt like that message was, like, really broad and kind of otherworldly and didn't really exactly apply to this tale as much as I felt like it was talking to me. Like, it was telling me to be the best that I can.
The time to part has come. We'll report to the sky. This planet's first memory. My happy memories of living with you. There's nothing to feel sad about. I will be with you for all eternity. Raindrops will become a vast river and gather in the sea. I hope that your wings will hold your own happiness.
Yes. Mm-hmm. The raindrops will fall to the sea, where they will be together forever. And then, mm-hmm. you know, evaporation to repeat the cycle or whatever. But, like,
cycle? Yep,
viewed it as, like, you're gonna love one another, and that's the way it's gonna be. And I'm gonna carry that message onwards for all eternity.
Mm-hmm.
So it's telling you to love, man, to just always love in spite of the fact that you will die.
Mm-hmm. We'll report to the sky, yeah. Yeah, man, like, there's a lot of confusing stuff. Like, I don't know who's saying that. Maybe, like, I was thinking maybe it's Sora? Maybe it's Kana speaking to Sora, or Sora speaking to Kana. Misuzu, whatever. But I think one thing I'm really happy about this podcast is we haven't been boggled down by the technicals so much as we have the meaning of it all. And you might not get the absolute answers you want to every little question, because I've been thinking about this for the last week and I'm still very confused on a lot of things. But what I do have a better sense of now is the reasons why these things were written and what they were trying to convey to the reader. I feel like I have a much better understanding of that now than I ever did before. Like, I'm glad.
That's the key right there. Like, that's hands down. That's the key way. There's always a very important life message that is being portrayed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No matter how fantastical, like, the setting is, the message is the same. I mean, fairy tales are there to guide children in a proper path, and they're completely and totally bathed in silliness, you know? I mean, like, it's cool, because, like, it goes back to when you think about, you see this scene through multiple perspectives, and obviously you see it once as Sora, whenever he's on the seawall, and Misuzu waves at the two on the beach. I read the quote earlier, but, like, a really interesting part was, in this instance, as Sora, as we are at this moment, in this kind of point in our repeating circle, Sora says that the children look like they're going somewhere, but also like they can't go anywhere at all.
Oh, yeah.
So I think that's really cool. I think that's really cool, because it's like, it's almost like saying that their time will come. Because obviously, like, Saika is still going to be a sickly girl in this existence. Mm-hmm. But, like, it's like saying, you're almost there. You know what I mean? Like, whenever you go and you are in the perspective of the boy, then they can go somewhere. Like, because of what Yukito, Masuzu, Haruko, Sora, what they did has been done, now they can move forward.
Some weird causality shit.
Yeah, because, like, because Sora says it's just like, they walk onwards unafraid of what awaits them.
Yeah. The end to the end of infinity.
And beyond.
Do that. So that's kind of like a last little connecting piece there.
To see what lies beyond, yeah. There's so much you can take from that scene, holy crap. I'm so happy they put it in. It's so cool. Like,
a lot of people see that scene, and like I said, they just kind of like, they don't know what to think about it. I was just like, well, it's you gotta just dig deep, man, and mm-hmm. try to like find something concrete, because it's there for a reason. And mm-hmm. like, the fact that you see it from these different perspectives just adds to that, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Like, it's, they definitely want you to focus on it.
Yeah, and that's the thing, you know, because it's abstract, we can form whatever interpretations we want. And that's okay. It's important to remember it's okay to decide on your own truth and not just whatever gets told to you, served to you, is the truth, you know. You got to figure that out for yourself. You got to decide in your heart what you believe this means. And I think we've offered some different perspectives on what
you have to find your own God.
Nice.
Doesn't matter what you chase, just as long as you're chasing what you believe in.
That's right. May your wings hold your own happiness. So I guess we're going to wrap things up here with a question. And I think Biz has been eager to ask this one.
Well, since you asked, I suppose I've kind of built up a little bit of a legacy now after our first book club experience. And I want everyone now, obviously we've just finished up our AIR podcast here, and the AIR book club is starting to just wind down and wrap up, but that doesn't mean it's winding down. We're going to end with a bang, baby. Mm-hmm. So, very, very important question. As I asked before, what does AIR mean to you? Aspie just said that it doesn't particularly matter what other people say is something is factually, but it's about what you take from it. What did the writer, what did Maida and all those other little fellows, what did they present to you, and how did it make you feel? Mm-hmm. How does it make you feel? What does AIR mean to you? I feel like it's very important that you think a good long while about this question. And, yeah.
We're going to give you a week. Because starting now is the... Well, maybe starting before this is published even. Depends when we get it out. But we'll have, for the last week, we're having the AIR Book Club Commemoration Week. And I'm just going to subtitle it with The End of Infinity. And so, as I mentioned earlier, you can use this time to go on the forum and you can join all those little topics that we've already covered in the book clubs and just share your last thoughts, because just looking at these guys here, we still have a lot to talk about that we can't fit into this little podcast. And it's going to be great to go back to all those old topics and share our new knowledge based on, you know, everything we've read, and share our final thoughts on AIR, and taking a moment to say, what does AIR mean to you? And if you want to reply to this, I definitely recommend checking out the AIR general topic. You can, or if it's really spoilery, then I guess you can use the AIR topic, the AIR root topic. But just share like a paragraph on what this VN means to you. And if it's like really nice, then we might even include it in our video we're doing, where we'll combine all the efforts of the book club into one little celebration video at the end of the week. We might have like some live readings of some of your forum comments, and just to like kind of get bring everything together. And we're hoping for some last minute fan arts for this final week. Like, we really want people to like get their creative spirits going. Like, you've already read AIR, now it's time to come together and produce something for it. So we want to see fan art, we want to see like videos and reviews and vlogs and blogs and forum posts and anything you want. Just make something to so we can like end this book club on a really good note. I'm going to be making stuff myself, and I'm hoping everybody else here has some ideas too. So it's really exciting, and I hope you can all join us for this last final stretch of the book club. Yeah? You guys looking forward to it?
Yeah.
Of course.
I'm going to dig deep into my inner key protagonist and give the best monologue you've ever heard.
You can look forward to that. We'll have it included on the video, of course. And so, yeah, I guess that wraps up the discussion for the AIR Book Club. All over, I think this has been an amazing experience. Like, the Planetarium Book Club was great, but I feel like we've really taken it to the next level with this book club, because, you know, obviously it's a much bigger work and so much more to talk about, but even just, you know, we've gotten a lot better at doing it too, and
we've also still learned a lot as well.
Yeah, we've still got a lot to learn, but
many bumps.
You know, we're improving a lot, and it's really starting to take on a very interesting form, and I'm so happy that you could all be a part of it with me. And thank you, of course, to Aizen for joining us for this final episode.
I'm welcome to be here.
So yeah, guys, did you enjoy being part of the book club, Bowie?
Oh, absolutely. It was, like I said during the interview process, it was, you know, it was a first-time thing for me, so I didn't really know how it would go. But it was, surprisingly. It was a ton of fun, actually.
Yeah. Jared, are you there?
Yes.
What do you think of being a part of this?
Oh, it was amazing. Like, even if I didn't have a lot to say a lot of the time, you know, I still really, really enjoyed being part of the discussion. And I think if not for this podcast, I don't think I would have enjoyed AIR.
Yeah, like, that's what I really hope too. Because, like, I mean, not that you can't enjoy things without a book club, but being part of a book club really, like, makes you experience something in a very different way than it would be to just reading it in your own time. And you really, like, it's that extra motivation to dig a little bit deeper and find something to really appreciate from the work. And I'm so glad that you said that, because that's basically what I really hope to accomplish with this book club. And I feel like a lot of people are getting a lot more out of AIR than they would otherwise. Would you agree with that, Biz?
Yep. I think so too. Like, you're never gonna, like, get more than whenever you're surrounded by different perspectives. Like, you're always, everybody's different, you know, mm-hmm. Every instrument sounds a little bit different. You're just gonna always get a unique perspective.
And obviously Link Thinks wasn't able to be here for this episode because he ended up being very sick today, unfortunately. But you know what? Let's just try and get a recorded message on the line. So, Link, what do you think of being a part of the AIR Book Club?
The AIR Book Club was just an amazing experience for me, because aside from just getting to spend some time every other week with Aspiredy, Bizkit Doe, Bowie, and Jared, and then whoever the extra guest was, be it Pepe, Yurian, or Aizen, there was such amazing discussion and insight to AIR that I would never realize if I was just reading on my own, and getting to snowball ideas off of each other, and the amazing contributions by our users on the forums just made it a great experience, and I'm really glad that I got to be part of the AIR Book Club with everybody else.
Thanks for sharing that, Link. And yeah, I guess let's wrap this up with an announcement that I'm sure some of you have been waiting for, the overall AIR Book Club MVP. And this came down to two people who have just been absolutely extraordinary. And those two people are Bowie and Aizen. You guys have just been amazing with your contribution to this book club. Like, Aizen has been on every topic, posting key point after key point after key point, and they've all been really good too. It's just, you just haven't stopped, Aizen. Like, holy crap. So much forum discussion. And Bowie, like, he's been on the forums too, but I feel like where he really shined was bringing that out in the podcast. You just, with all those crazy points just keep coming out. Like, the freaking Apsara thing and the Tenon just ended up being so relevant, like, now. Like, we haven't even talked about that yet, but if you just look into the Tenon, well, we talked a little bit about it, but just, it just keeps coming back. Just, you look into stuff so well, and you keep bringing out these things that I never would have even thought possible.
Presents it really well, too. Very, excited, and it's always very interesting to hear. Like, it kind of rubs off on you. It's just like, oh, yeah, like, you start feeling it.
Yeah, I just, I, like, my thing in this podcast is I have to reach Bowie's level now, because it's set a precedent. And so, it was a very hard decision, but in the end, I've decided to go with Bowie as the MVP. Congratulations, Bowie!
Hi, punch, punch, punchy!
Thank you!
Do you have any words to
share? I find it very interesting that you say that. You want to know why I find it interesting that you say that? I've been keeping a little tally of my own here. My biz points, as I like to call them. Actually, I didn't call them that. Someone else called them that, but we'll roll with it. And with a grand total of 2,350 biz points, Bowie is my personal choice for the AIR
Book You kept Club. A running tally?
Most valued potato.
Yeah! Well done, buddy. Pico!
I can't tell you what your prizes are just yet, but you're going to get some, and they're going to be cool.
Yep. And you're going to get a special prize from me as well. Anyways, you like the show?
Yeah, actually, like, I appreciate it. I really do. Like I said, whenever I was coming in, it was sort of, whenever I heard about the book club, which is what brought me to Kaza in the first place, and now I've sort of, you know, become entrenched in the community now, that, you know, I thought,
you can't leave.
I thought, I don't plan on it, but I thought, you know, the book club sounds fun, and, you know, the podcast part of it sounds fun. I've never done podcasts, but I've heard them, and, you know, it always sounds like everybody has a lot of fun with it. And I was pleasantly surprised that I was right. And then, you know, we were talking about what we enjoyed about the book club, and, you know, Jared touched on it, and then everybody, I loved the fact that how much you feed off each other. Like, even when you're stumped on something, somebody else, even if they don't have the answer, will have at least a piece of the puzzle that contributes. So, you know, I'm thankful.
That's what I was really hoping with this episode.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah, I came into this episode stumped on more than I could even attempt to figure out. And, you know, I feel like, you know, I've learned even recording this podcast. So, you know, you know, thanks for letting me be a part of it, pretty much.
No problem. And Ice, did you want to say a few words too as the runner-up?
It's been such a pleasure to have been able to be here at this exact moment for the AIR Book Club. Because like Bowie, I came here because I found out about the AIR Book Club and I was intrigued. I came and I brought my passion and my writing talent here, and it's been a long journey.
It's paid off, man. Your efforts haven't gone unnoticed. I'm sorry that I couldn't give out like two prizes, but you've definitely been noticed, and thank you so much for your contributions, because the book club wouldn't be what it is without your exemplary efforts in it. So thank you very much from the bottom of my heart.
You're welcome.
And I guess now that we've got that out of the way, and we've talked about everything there is to talk about, it's time for special announcements. Ooh-hoo-hoo. Me and Biz have been cooking some things up, and not one, but two announcements I have to make today. The first is something that I guess I've like foreshadowed quite a bit, so it won't be a surprise to most of you, but maybe some of you haven't heard of it. Clannad Book Club, it's coming, baby. We're going to ring in the launch of Clannad on Steam with the book club. And we're still working out the technical details. We might get some feedback from the community on that. Like, we don't know whether we're going to do 2-week routes or 1-week routes. That's something we're still,
yeah,
like,
we're debating about that a lot. Have to learn a good way to kind of streamline these podcast processes.
Because it's going to be long.
Yeah, we've been having quite a few little bumps and things, so we're going to have to see what we're going to do. But we're going to figure something out, because it's going to happen.
We got a Van Murphy from future podcast segments.
Yeah, Murphy keeps showing up, man. We don't have time for everything happening.
Yep, exactly. And so, you know, it's obviously going to be a long one. We'll probably have a new round of auditions for the podcast for that one. Don't know how many people will be on. Maybe a little bit less people than this one, I think. I don't know, me and Business. We're still working out the technical details, but, what was that, Aizen?
Don't expect me to be here for this next one.
You're gonna be busy at that time. Right?
I'm gonna be going on my own journey.
<It's> exciting. Well, when you come back, Kazumatsuri.org will be waiting for you.
I'll expect it to be, hopefully. Actually, I don't know what I will expect it to be.
that's probably the safe answer.
Hopefully the same.
Well, I'm sure we'll still be the same friendly community.
We'll be busy translating Angel Beats.
Don't say that.
Now formally announcing the Kazumatsuri Translation Group.
No.
Moe Boys Treat TL.
Moe Boys Translations.
No.
What a turn this subs. Has
taken. That wasn't the
shocking announcements.
Oh dear. But that's quite a while away. Like, it's, what is it, May at the moment, and the release of the Clannad visual novel on Steam is going to be like October, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I think it was October.
Yeah, that sounds right.
And so it's still a while off, but in the meantime, we've got a lot of stuff happening. Well, actually, I'll say it right now. We were going to put a canon book club in, but we've decided against it because there's just too much other stuff coming out at the same time. And, you know, I'm sorry to all the people that were hoping to get canon done before Clannad, but we'll definitely get to it as soon as we can. That'll probably be coming after the Clannad book club. However, as I said, there's a lot of stuff happening in between then, and you bet we're going to take advantage of it. Announcing the Charlotte Podcast, tentative title.
We can't call it a book club because it's not really
Don't call it a book club.
Yeah, I guess it kind of is.
It's not really a book club, but what we're going to be doing is at the end of, like, once a week, at the end of the week, where we'll get a couple of people together and discuss the latest episode of Charlotte that's just aired on television. And, you know, the podcast will be, like, quite a bit smaller than what you've gotten used to here. Like, there might be, like, 20 minutes, maybe half an hour.
It's like I said a second ago, we definitely have quite a bit to learn about, you know, kind of streamlining our process here. So I feel like this is actually going to be a really good way to kind of learn to be able to just kind of get with it, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
To learn how to, good ways to kind of pick up the pace.
Yeah. So we still need to decide on a cast for that, but definitely look forward to it, because there's going to be like forum topics where everyone's going to be talking about Charlotte, and we're going to bring it all together in these little mini podcast things. I guess they're more normal sized podcasts compared to the rest of the world, but but yeah, so I'm personally really excited about that, because I am feeling the Charlotte hype. But yeah, just there's all sorts of stuff coming out, not just Charlotte. We got like the Harvest Festa fan translation is nearly finished. We have Harmonia will be coming out sometime in the near future. We don't know when yet, but it's happening. And Angel Beats First Beat is getting a release next month in June. On top of that, we're probably going to get like a Little Busters X translation sometime soon, hopefully. You know, all the things are happening at once. It's going to be a crazy year for Key.
It's the year of Key.
So, it really is. Like, the 50th anniversary is really shaping up to be an amazing year for Key. And just, Kazumatsu.org has its hands full covering all that stuff, but we're going to have a lot of fun with it too. So I hope you'll continue to join us for the ride, because it's going to be amazing.
We hope that you'll choose us as the place to talk about it all, because, oh, there's a lot to talk about, so come on.
Absolutely.
Join us.
And with that, I'll be bringing the AIR Book Club podcast to a close. I'm your host, Aspiety. We also have Biscuit there with me today.
Ciao.
We have Aizen Kobu as our guest for this episode.
The end of infinity lies ahead. Everyone, farewell.
We have Aetheria.
Yahoo!
And we also have our very own MVP, Bowie.
Bye-bye!
And Link thinks sends his regards from beyond the sickness that he's enduring right now. So thank you once again for joining me, everybody. Thank you for joining me on the podcast, guys. It's been an amazing pleasure. And we hope you look forward to what comes next.
Farewell for now, and let us meet again at the end of infinity.
No hila de cosutemos.